All right. Well, thanks to everybody who can join us. We had some lively conversation kind of getting started on this. A couple things about the team. Mark is not here today.
He's in the chat.
Mark is out of the office, and there's a new logo on the bottom left there, I think. That might have just, how did that happen? Derek, did you do that?
I did not.
Yourself?
Did I do that?
You have to call you Sir Derek now? Is that
you do. You do. Nobody else does, but you do.
Well, given that the other four people in this photo have that same logo and I don't, I think I might have to.
We'll just give you an LVP logo and then
I have one. I made one. Yeah, it's much more efficient that way. You only need to have one and not five, right?
Right.
So Mark is at ECS in Dusseldorf this week, and Derek is our freshly minted MVP. We're really excited and want to offer our congratulations to a culmination of a lot of hard work. And I think from the other MVPs on this call, you probably would tell them that the hard work is just beginning.
Yes.
I would think.
Yes.
Yep. So, I would make a joke about him still having that new MVP smell, but that's probably not.
No.
That's not what that smell is. That's vodka. Okay, sorry.
And cranberry.
I hit back. Today's topic, the third in our three-part set of conversations about Teams and SharePoint, kind of the combination of what to use when and how they're better together. So we talked about a couple of specific use cases, organization news, keeping people informed, search experiences, and external collaboration. So we'll dive right into that. Not an or, but an and resource. Okay, these are the use cases that we brought up in prior conversations that we wanted to drill into a bit today. So as we go, please utilize the chat. I know Julie is great at monitoring the chat while I'm sharing my whole screen, or chime in if you've got other scenarios, questions about what we're talking about. We really want for this to be a dialogue and not a presentation. So please, and I think you've been great about this in the past, don't be shy. First use case we want to talk about is organizational news. And Emily, I'll let you take it from here for now.
So this is one where a lot of people may not even be asking themselves yet SharePoint or Teams, because you might still be stuck in sharing organizational news via email, which I strongly recommend considering to start sharing your news from SharePoint. That way, all of your content, when someone wants to search a subject, is in one place. So instead of having, let's say we have some organizational news about an HR benefits update, if that's an email, but when someone goes to your intranet to that HR benefits site and that information isn't there, you're asking them to check two places, and it's really likely that they're going to miss that information. So even though right now I'm saying start in SharePoint to post news, pretty soon, January 2022, they announced at Ignite, you'll actually be able to create pages from Teams. So pretty soon this is going to be a both, but the underlying place that you're posting is a SharePoint site. Now, you might be wondering, someone is posting news in a SharePoint site, but we are in our Teams client all day, we're not really going to the SharePoint site at all. Well, on our next slide, we have a screenshot of the SharePoint News connector. So you can connect the SharePoint News from your Teams site to any of the channels in your connected Microsoft team. So when you post a news post on that SharePoint site, it comes into the channel conversation and can alert everybody.
And Emily, this is just for group-backed team sites, right?
Correct.
Okay, got it. News that you post to a team site that's backed by a group.
Right. If you're sharing organizational news on a communication site, you can email that from SharePoint out, and you can also make auto news digests, which do that automatically for you, or you can make a curated news digest, which is kind of like a newsletter, where you can take multiple articles from multiple sites and put them in that one email.
Or also, we have the Viva Connections connector to the home site. So if news rolls up to a home site, I have one-click access to it from Teams, and I can also create a tab on any team for filtered views of news, correct, or curated views of news?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And then the next spot that we have where our news is showing, again, we're starting in SharePoint as of today, can start from SharePoint or Teams in the future, but we can see it anywhere we have the SharePoint app bar. So we do have that one tab in our SharePoint app bar for all that roll-up of news that you have access to.
Cool. Lots of good stuff there. And then, of course, you've got the home Viva Connections version of this, too.
Absolutely.
So and before I flip to enterprise search and our favorite phrase of all time as consultants, it depends. Anything else on organizational news? Any other points? I didn't know about the SharePoint News Connector to surface it in the general channel of a team. Certainly familiar with the Viva Connections and the My News in the App Bar, et cetera. But I love that. I thought that was great.
Yeah.
The only other thing is right now you can share these different news pages to email and to Yammer, and pretty soon in 2022 you'll also be able to share to Teams. So let's say there is a piece of news on a communication site that impacts your working group who has a Teams backed site, and you want to share that communication site news to your Microsoft team, you'll be able to do that as well.
So it'll just be in addition to share via email, share via Yammer, share via Teams.
Yep.
Awesome.
We have a comment about from Hilde. We have added some SharePoint pages, but not all web parts work, e.g. call to action link only works going to SharePoint, not into Teams. And that makes some sense to me because Teams requires like a deep link type link. It's a very special link. I'm not sure what'll end up happening if you're viewing the page that's like pinned to a tab or pinned to a private channel in Teams. It'll probably just work because the iframe will redirect to where you want them to go. But yeah, I think you're right. You're not going to be able to deep link into Teams, and I bet that won't happen anytime soon. And I mentioned the Viva Connections thing already, which is just surfacing that, giving you a new place to navigate for that centralized news. Oh, we have a hand raised. I don't know who that is. Hello. Hand is. Oh, Krista.
It's me.
Hi, Krista.
A question about branding on the News Digest. I know there's plans for some branding capabilities to come about, but do you know to the extent of what will be available in terms of making something a little bit more organizational branded versus SharePoint and Microsoft branded for the News Digest or emails?
I don't have any details on that. Does anyone else at Simpraxis?
No, I do not.
I know for the current workaround is to send the News Digest to yourself, delete out those JPEGs that are in the top, because it's essentially JPEGs pasted into a table and then send it out. But I do hear you loud and clear how annoying that is to do every single time. And with the auto News Digest, you don't have that opportunity as you do with when you're manually curating them.
Yeah.
All right, I'll keep an eye on the roadmap. Thank you.
We'll do the same. All right, want to talk about enterprise search?
Yeah. So another thing they announced at Ignite was this new enterprise search experience in Teams. And so we're sort of talking about search in the enterprise and, you know, SharePoint versus Teams. Now, SharePoint has had the new search experience, the Microsoft 365 search experience for couple years, I think, whenever they moved that search bar to the middle of the screen, you're searching not only SharePoint, but sort of your related information. And so they built and brought a similar experience to Teams. And I mean, thank God for first, because the search experience in Teams is pretty horrible. This is in public preview. So you have to have either your Teams org, and it's a setting in the admin center in Teams, or your particular client set to public preview so that you can see this feature. But essentially, when you do a search, so you have the search bar at the top of Teams, and you'll type in whatever search phrase you want to do, and you hit enter, you're going to get a different search results screen. And so this is the search results screen that you get, and you start on an all tab. And essentially what it's going to just give you is the messages, people and files that match your search. However, keep in mind, this search results are going to be somewhat scoped to Teams itself. So messages, obviously, are messages shared in Teams. Files are ones shared with the teams that you have access to and the people. The people is more global, but they're team members, right? So you can see their Teams card and whatever. So this is what all looks like. And then Mike, if you hit the button, it's a build screen. So then in messages, which is, so this is where the rubber meets the road for me in the horrible search experience that we used to have with Teams. Now messages has some filtering that you can do on the search results. And this is so how, I mean, I can't tell you the number of times, like, for instance, Derek and I are chatting about some technical thing and we'll share a link or whatever. And I know what we were talking about, but it was 3 days ago. And since we chat with each other, like probably once an hour, we have a lot of chat messages. So to like get back a day or two, I mean, scrolling, and it's a horrible scrolling experience because it refreshes and then drops you down. So as you're scrolling back, you keep getting jerked around, really. So to be able to say, hey, I'm searching for this message. I actually don't remember what team I was in when this message happened, you know, this post was in. I do remember the date, you know, to be able to filter like that. Awesome. So that's a really good new feature. And then if you press the button, so people is going to give you what we kind of expect out of SharePoint search. You're going to get the person information. And if you hover over that, you're going to get the people card that we expect. And so it's the same people card that you see everywhere. So that's pretty cool. And then again, last but not least, files. Again, you do the search. Now, again, you got some more filtering options here, which could really help. So these are going to be files shared with you in Teams. And, you know, so it's scoped to that. But of course, all of these files are shared and saved in the underlying SharePoint site. So you could search in SharePoint and get similar results, but this just gives you a surface to do it in the context of where you're working. So that can be super powerful. So that was all I had on enterprise search.
Yeah, and I don't have anything real specific to bring onto this other than just to talk about how much the M365 wide search, you know, now that's in the sweet bar, like you mentioned, I use that all the time. Like I almost don't even try to find things manually anymore. Like if I'm someplace and I need to find a statement of work for a customer or something, wherever I'm at, I just don't even try to remember anymore. I just go search. It's not perfect, but it's pretty good. So if folks aren't leveraging that already, I recommend that because it's working out pretty well.
And Todd, I think this gets particularly interesting when the conversations tab, which just shows Yammer conversations, lets me drill into Teams specific content instead of, now I've got two search experiences, right?
Yeah.
One in the sweet bar and one is Teams specific. And the Teams specific one's getting better, but until it's integrated with the rest, I feel like it's still a bifurcated experience.
Yeah, and I'm like Julie, like I can never remember when or where I talked to somebody about something. So having that all in one place and not have the search experience in Teams. I use Teams against my will. Like I don't like Teams much, and it's all these little things. Like it's growing on me. They're fixing it, but things like the search, I'm like, ugh. But yeah, hopefully the search improvements will warm it to me a little more.
Can we have like a future topic of like the five most annoying things about Teams right now? Knowing that they're going to change and that might.
Why only five? It's so limiting. It's like
trying to get one per person.
Yeah.
That would be interesting. Oh, yeah. I guess if people are interested in that. Do that and then submit what your things are. Maybe we have some workarounds or something.
And at the very least, we can commiserate with you. Oh, yeah, that sucks. I hate that, too.
That Teams.
So Iris has a – Iris, you have a question?
Yeah, I'm answering it right in the chat.
It's a two-parted question. When you're searching in Teams now and you search for a part of a conversation, find the keyword, and you want to open the conversation, but you only get that one message, is that changing in this?
Yeah, so the screenshot I just put in the chat, when you do a search, you're going to get that card and it's going to show you sort of portion of the message. But then when you hover over it, there's a new button that says go to message. And that button takes you to that where you were in the chat.
So not just the message itself, but the conversation or the team.
Right, exactly. Oh, so now I hit go to message and now I'm they've brought that. So I, that particular message, I clicked go to message and it brought me to that person I was chatting with to that message. And now I see above and below and I can scroll.
Right. The other part of the question I wanted to ask is regarding like search results as well in content role web parts, being able to or do you know if there are any changes in being able to customize what columns and fields are being displayed in display templates like we had on premise? Any word on that?
Well, not out of the box. There's, I think Microsoft is even still recommending using the PNP search web parts to be able to create your own custom display templates.
Right.
Yeah, I think that's still where we are.
Yeah, and if you're using the PNP search web part, you can pull in any crawled or managed property that you have and just pull it into the UI.
Good to know. Thank you.
Yeah.
We did a session on that too. So you could watch that and we do, I think we did some demos. It's been a little bit, but we did do a session on that one.
I'll look that up. Thank you.
That is one of our favorite Swiss Army knife web parts. That learning pathways and the PNP web part, search web part, are like the two go-tos that I always like to make sure are installed on every client.
Cool. So right.
Let's go to number three. Use case number three we had in mind to talk about today was external collaboration. Times when we could use one or the other, what the use cases are that we're talking about, and some of the things to look out for.
So that one's me, right? Yeah. Yep. So I think it really, it depends on really what the main objective is for that external collaboration. If it's a publishing model, so if it's externally, you know, it's you or, you know, organization A pushing information out. So think like a logo portal or a marketing portal that external vendors can get access to and pull information down. If that's the use case, I think it's really, that's probably a better choice for SharePoint, because you can use a communication site, you can allow folks in, you have control over who gets edit access versus read access, and you can sort of dial that down. If you're in a situation where you need to actively collaborate with somebody, working on a document or chat or sharing specs or something like that, then it's more of a two-way communication vehicle. Then I think Teams is probably the better choice in that use case. Some things to keep in mind, obviously, you know, if you're co-authoring content, then probably Teams is probably the best place for it, because then you've got everybody right in there in the same spot. But you need to think about permissions, because in Teams, you're either a member of the team and you can edit everything in there, or you can't. There's no sort of read-only lurker status. I think didn't we talk about that last time or the couple of sessions of times, ago? Yeah. And you really do need to make sure you look at your external sharing settings to make sure that those are turned on, especially if you're using external guests. And, you know, we were joking about this in our prep session, you know, where do you want your pain, right? It's around authentication. Switching tenants is like the bane of every, you know, consultant's existence. You know, I've got six or seven tenants and trying to move from one to the other is just a huge pain, just so that I can collaborate with folks in another organization. But it's either that, or do your users have, do they have a different login, right? Do they need to use the browser and use SharePoint and log in and have separate Chrome profiles for each tenant, of which I think all of us have many, depending on which tenant or which thing, so it really depends on where you want your pain. Authentication against multiple tenants is a giant pain in the butt. So just making sure that you are aware of that when you start to think about externally collaborating with folks.
Yeah.
I have, go ahead. No, go, Todd.
I was going to say, to build on top of that, that's the approach that I took. And I've been using Edge for a while, though Chrome does this also. I've created a PWA, a progressive web app, of the Teams web app. So if you go to teams.microsoft.com and you can do your browsing in Edge, if you go up in the right-hand corner and click one of the many things up there, there's a bunch of them. But one of them is going to give you the option of installing this page as an app. And then it installs that Teams web page as a standalone app. Big fan of that. So I do that for a bunch of, I probably got a dozen PWAs set up. The big advantage of that over just a regular Teams web page is it's a separate web browser instance that doesn't catch any of the clicks. So if I click something in that Teams thing, it doesn't open up as another tab inside of there. It stays just a Teams app. And then I use it the way in both of the scenarios that Derek talked about. I have, so right now I've got it up, and both the Teams client and my PWA are in the Simpraxis tenant, but they're in different chats, so I can bounce back and forth as opposed to dialing through there. But it does have my tenant picker at the top, so I can pop back and forth. The Teams PWA is the only thing that has made Teams tolerable for me, honestly, because it is just the multi-tenant experience is horrible, and this kind of helps a little bit. And it's Ruth approved also, I see in the chat. So
Mike Dixon made the comment about what our thoughts with the upcoming connected channel feature. Before I want to say something about that, I was going to say, the one thing that I like is from an organizational standpoint, from like an IT admin perspective, if you're going to be collaborating with other organizations and chatting with the other people in other organizations, let's hope that your IT people set up federation with those other organizations so that you can do the chat right from your Teams instance to that other org. Like, for instance, Simpraxis is federated with Microsoft. So that means that I can start a chat in from Simpraxis's tenant. I can be in Simpraxis's tenant Teams and start a chat with somebody with an @microsoft.com address and have that chat be one of my many chats versus having to go to my progressive web app, which I also do. I really love that feature, Todd, and have that chat be over there so that I'm chatting in that progressive web app with Microsoft people and I'm only in with Simpraxis people in my Simpraxis version. So having them all in one, I think that super helps. And then so to go back to what Mike is talking about, which is the connected channel feature. I think I've seen some stuff about it. I don't know that I fully grok exactly what's going to happen, but effectively, the idea is that if you are a guest in a team, so like if Microsoft has added me my Simpraxis account as a guest in one of Microsoft's teams, then any of the shared channel thing is that I can see that channel in my Simpraxis tenant desktop client. So I'll be in the Simpraxis desktop client and I'll go to Teams and I'll see that team, but with the shared channel that is the one that I was given access to, and thereby I can interact in that same desktop client. Since I have not been able to experience it yet, I don't know that I know how I feel about it. I think it's going to be confusing. I think as a user, I'm going to really like it. As a trying to architect things and trying to understand security and architecture, I think this is going to be very confusing for almost everyone, like how to get that right. And so that's my take.
As another IT perspective, so a couple of things about that. Microsoft has said, and again, I don't think it's fully available yet, that you will not be able to switch an existing channel to a shared channel. So shared channel and Teams Connect are the same thing. They've changed the names a couple of times. So you'll have to create it that way whole cloth, which is probably good because that way you don't accidentally expose something that was already out there. And it'll have a different icon in your bar, so people will be able to see when they put stuff there that there are external folks in there. As an IT person, one of the things that it's going to do, much like the private channels do, is it's going to create another darn hidden site in there. And so I think the governance and discoverability of those will be challenging for IT folks like the private channels are. But if the story that the Microsoft marketing folks tell is 80% true, it will be another nice tool to have, because then it won't require the federation that we talked about. Then it can be the guest thing, but you get a better experience and you won't have to switch tenants. Microsoft, it appears, will do anything to prevent fixing the multi-tenant experience in Teams. They will do 100 workarounds as opposed to fix that one thing.
And I wonder, because the people who are complaining most and most loudly about it are partners, not customers, right? Most of our clients live in one tenant, their own. We have to live in seven tenants if we have seven clients we're working with concurrently all the time. So we're the ones with the problem. I think the people who are writing the big checks to Microsoft for 50,000 licenses, et cetera, 7 seats of Teams, not a big issue for them.
Yeah,
it probably isn't. It isn't, Mike, but I think the problem is that the feature is kind of on. And so now people can, especially if you have sort of a self-serve organization, especially a big self-serve organization, the accidental use of those features, you know, I mean, we don't know yet, right? It's not out particularly, but like, I'm just worried about that part of it, right? The private channel thing is bad enough with the proliferation of all those, you know, sort of hidden team sites.
Or that.
You know, SharePoint sites.
Collections, yeah.
Right. But now that we're going to have more with the sort of shared channel situation, and that has a whole other security paradigm. I mean, I'm sure it's a great feature for some people and for some scenarios. I just wish it could be a thing like, hey, we'll opt into this because we're going to use that feature. We understand that feature and we know how we're going to, you know, governance that feature. Right,
how we're going to govern versus the proliferation of new site collections that people never even see via
SharePoint. Right, exactly.
UI. I got you.
Yeah.
I'm with you. You and I have eaten that same dirt for years on a couple of clients.
Somebody somewhere will like it. I'm just sure of it. Somebody.
No, but I meant the single pane of glass across the multi-tenant viewer situation. It's our problem as partners more so than it is our
clients' absolutely problems. Which is why I said, as a user, I'll probably love it.
I
believe that. I think as Microsoft makes Teams more ubiquitous and pushes more people towards that, it's going to result in those kind of multi-tenant issues that we have becoming a bigger deal.
Good, right? Because that'll drive prioritization. Cool. Last slide, a couple of resources that we put together to follow up on today. If you want to dig deeper into some of the news and search experiences, 2 weeks from today, we're going to do a little bit of something different, kind of a holiday special in keeping with the Island of Misfit Toys from the holiday special that a lot of us grew up watching on TV. We're going to talk about Microsoft's Island of Misfit Toys. So our favorite features that have been deprecated, products that are in the product graveyard, et cetera, that we're using. And we'll talk about the Island of Misfit Toys in 2 weeks. So bring your favorite long-lost Microsoft product or tool. We will not be hosting the meeting in live meeting, I'm pretty sure.
Good one.
I think we'll stick with Teams for that, probably.
I'll bring my Zoom and play the music.
I'll call you on my kin.
I have a Windows RT tablet that still works. So
there we go. I got my Windows phone right here. Hold on. Yeah. There it is.
Oh, I do too. I do too. Here's one.
So if anybody wants to geek out on those that have departed, we're going to do like an in memoriam, like they do at the Oscars, of like whoever died that year of Microsoft features and products. But we're going to talk about the Island of Misfit Toys next time.
Maybe we'll do the in memoriam in January.
There you go.
It's a dark month anyway, sure.
It is. Dark all the things completely in the dark, so.
All the things that died in 2021.
God. Anything else in the chat for us to cover? We're right about at time.
I don't see anything.
I just want to mention how smoothly this whole Ask Some Praxis went without Mark.
God, so valid.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I didn't.
Be honest with it. Yeah.
My heart rate's been low the whole time. I haven't felt that constant agitation. I don't know. It's probably just a coincidence, though, right?
Oh, it's just a coincidence.
It's just being recorded. Thanks, Mark.
We love you, Mark.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us and chiming in, bringing your questions, your own experiences. We appreciate it. We look forward to talking to you in 2 weeks.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, guys.